Yeah, I'm presenting a project which will be completely different, and maybe this talk will be also very different to any physical talks you heard on conferences so far, because what I want to present today is an algorithm. If you want, it's also maybe a software project we have in our mind, and I hope that it will become more clear during my talk. What I mean by that. So the idea or the aim of our algorithm which we have is to automate the process of finding superconducting circuits. And to do that, I first want to start showing you a little bit what is the idea behind the algorithm. Maybe I'm not sure how many people of you are familiar with superconducting circuits, so I'll also touch on that a little bit, what superconducting circuits are, and what our idea is, and why we think it is worthwhile to invest time and money to build such an algorithm, and what our algorithm should do. And then I'll show you how we realized the algorithm, what were the specific steps we introduced, and then I'll show you a little bit like how we exploited this algorithm, or how we are planning to exploit the algorithm. The pointer is a little bit slower. Let's start with the idea. So I found this wonderful table in the internet. Maybe it's a little bit small, but I'll show you what you should look at, maybe. So this is from quantumcomputingreport.com, which I find is a nice platform that always tries to keep up with the state-of-the-art technology regarding quantum technologies and quantum computers. And this table, you'll find a lot of different tables on this website, and this table deals with the different platforms people use to build quantum computers. So the first column here, it says, adiabatic quantum computing. So this is actually not a platform, that's just a way of doing computing. That's what Clemens was talking about before. And then the next column is already a very important platform, namely the so-called superconducting qubits. And as you can see, as there are a lot of crosses here, there are a lot of companies and institutes and universities who are using this technology to actually build a quantum computer. Then we have trapped ions. Trapped ions is also something which is from my home university, which my home university is kind of famous for that. So that would be this row here, MIT and University of Innsbruck. But of course, also trapped ions are at other institutes. Then we have cold and neutral atoms, which I think also Rydberg atoms would fall under this category. Spin and quantum dots, photonics, NV diamonds, and topological. So these are just, you know, this is not a complete list, but this is a sums up a lot of projects and a lot of different approaches to build a quantum computer. And I think that's a very important question to ask, how would we actually build a quantum computer? And I also added some numbers. So these numbers are maybe now outdated. I checked them last week. But so these are qubit numbers. Of course, the number itself doesn't tell the whole story, but just to give you a feeling. So the biggest number, of course, is D-Wave. With around 2,000, they announced 5,000, but according to this platform, it's not available yet. Then we have 72 with Google, 53 IBM, 49 Intel, and these are all superconducting qubits, also D-Wave. Of course, they're different. The difference is in the coherence time and the defacing time, but that's also, so that's what I was saying, the number itself is not doesn't tell the whole story, but just to give you a notion, in Innsbruck, we can control around 20 ions in the trap. I think that's, just to give you an idea of what we are talking about, there's Rigetti, this startup, I think it's based in North America, with around 16 qubits available right now. And in this talk, I will now tell you a little bit more about the column which I marked in yellow here, the superconducting qubits. So what are the superconducting circuits? What are superconducting qubits? This is a picture of the Martini's group. And just to give you an idea how this would look in reality. And since we had, during lunch yesterday, I asked around like how familiar you are with superconducting qubits, and I thought maybe not all of you have been working in this before, so I added two little bit tutorial slides to give you a little bit of an idea about the platform. So I'll start with the only thing physicists understand, which are the harmonic oscillator. And I think once you understood the harmonic oscillator, you already understood a lot. And if you think about your high school, maybe you remember the so-called LC circuit. So the LC circuit is just an inductance, which could be a coil, and a capacitor, a capacitance in parallel. And normally, if you think about electrical circuits, you would build them maybe with semiconductor material. But as the name tells, we are only thinking about superconducting material, because we want to operate the whole, all of these circuits in the quantum regime. And if we want to convey quantum information inside these circuits, we need a coherent system. And if you cool down superconducting materials below the critical temperature, the resistance for the charges vanishes, and this gives you the base of coherence you need to do quantum information. And that's why we're always thinking about superconducting material. Okay, coming back to the LC circuit, so this is a circuit with two nodes. There's one node, and these nodes corresponds to a flux and charge, which are actually the variables that describe the whole system. The other node I set here to the ground. That means that that one is zero. And we'll only need one node to describe the whole circuit. Now, for the LC circuit, if you write down the energy inside this circuit, you would have the energy which is stored in the field of the inductor. This is this term, which could be seen as the potential energy. And then you have an additional energy term which is stored in the field of the capacitor. This could be seen as the kinetic energy. If you express this via the flux and the charge, it looks like this. Now compare this Hamiltonian to the Hamiltonian you're all used to, namely the harmonic oscillator Hamiltonian, and you see if you make the transition by corresponding the flux to the momentum and the position to the charge, you have the harmonic oscillator. And by cooling down the whole circuit, you can bring it into the quantum regime. And the way we deal with quantum harmonic oscillators is, as you all know, we replace the position and the momentum, which is now the charge and the flux, by the ladder operators. So Q will be replaced by A dagger minus A, and phi by an expression which has A dagger plus A. And then the Hamiltonian will look like this, where omega, the frequency of the oscillator, is 1 over the square root L times C. And as you can see, all the levels in a harmonic oscillator are equidistant. And this is very bad if you want to build a qubit. Because if you want to build a qubit with that, and if you say, let's say the ground state is the zero and the first excited state is the one, if you probe one transition at the same time, you're also probing all the other transitions. So I think people also argue, if you want to see any quantum effects, you always need, at some point, something unharmonic. So luckily, there is an element which is very important for superconducting circuits that gives you this unharmonicity. And this is the so-called Josephson junction. Below here, you see a cartoon picture of a Josephson junction. A Josephson junction basically consists of a superconducting material and another superconducting material. It could be the same material, but two areas, which is blocked by a barrier. Now in superconducting materials, the charge carriers are not electrons, as you might be used to, but the charge carriers are the so-called Cooper pairs. So these Cooper pairs now depicted by this red circle here, and there is a certain chance that a Cooper pair will tunnel through the barrier from one side to the other. And this effect, when you replace the inductance by the so-called Josephson junction, will replace the phi squared term, as we had before with the harmonic oscillator, with now a potential that has a cosine term. And as you know, the cosine is an unharmonic potential. And since it's unharmonic also, and I over-exaggerated it here a little bit, the energy levels inside this potential will have different spacings. Now with this new element, we can actually do quantum computing. Because since the level spacing is now different to all these transitions, we can do a two-level approximation and operate this circuit as a quantum bit. And this is just part of the story, because in superconducting circuits, there are also other ways to build qubits. This is a transmon-type qubit, but there are also flux qubits and phase qubits. But in our project, we are all only considered with transmon-type qubits so far. So if you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt me. But that was my small tutorial to superconducting circuits. Just one more slide about, in general, about superconducting circuits. As every qubit platform, it has its features and it also has its drawbacks. One of the features is it's highly customizable. That means you can change the qubits to your needs. You can design them to your needs. If you go to nature and you pick any atom, all the atom from the same species will be the same. They'll have the same transition, but here you can customize it. You can also, since you can customize it, engineer very strong interactions. So normally, the probe is in the frequency of microwaves. So we are engineering a coupling between these qubits, as you saw before, and microwaves. But all these features also come with drawbacks at the same time, because it's in the nature of the platform. Since it's customizable, also the parameters tend to spread. Since it's a man-made object, no transmon, you won't find two transmons which are exactly the same. And since also you can engineer strong coupling, at the same time, you're also engineering a strong coupling with the environment, and that's something you don't want, because it introduces decoherence to your system. But I think it's a very interesting discussion about which qubit platform will be well suited, and I think all of the platforms have its features and its drawbacks. Okay, so what is the challenge in superconducting qubits? And I now took here an example from the history of superconducting qubits. And one of the big challenges is to find the right circuit to build a qubit. And one of the qubits people have been working with in the 90s was the so-called Cooper pair box. And the Cooper pair box is basically just a Josephson junction in zero with a capacitor and a voltage support. And with these voltage support, you could actually tune the qubit and do operations on it. The problem which is connected to that is that it is very sensible to charge noise. People around 10 years later came up with a circuit which is now called the transmon. And the circuit here looks a little bit difficult or complicated, but it basically is just a Josephson junction which is shunted by a capacitor. By shunting this capacitor, you reduce the sensibility to the charge noise on the qubit, and this gives you a much better qubit to operate on. So as you see, a slight change in the circuit can already have a dramatic impact on how the qubit can be operated for quantum computing. So the traditional approach the community designed circuits so far was always the following. If you want, there are only three elements. There are a little bit more, but the three most important elements are capacitances, inductances, and Josephson junction. And in the past, physicists combined these elements to build a circuit, and then analyzed this circuit and looked at their quantum properties, and also used these circuits to build a quantum computer. But so far, in the traditional approach, everything is based on the experience of this physicist who combines these elements. Our idea was, why shouldn't we kind of substitute the physicist by a computer and let the computer try out new circuits and play around with these circuits, and at the same time also simulate the properties these circuits would have if we would have them in the lab. And another step we want to add is we want to put a wish list to this whole protocol, which tells you certain properties we want to have from a qubit. And with these wish lists, it can be compared to the properties and feedback loop to the computer. The algorithm can try out new circuits and can try to get closer to the goal we have in mind. And the way we want to do that, I'll show you later. And also how we are doing that, I'll show you just in a moment. But one important ingredient would be some sort of genetic algorithm where the computer just mutates the circuits and adds new elements and removes elements. And this could be done with Monte Carlo. Or in a combinational approach, we could also use machine learning for that and, for example, teach a neural net how the correspondence between a circuit and a Hamiltonian and ask this machine learning system to generate circuits for us. Okay, so this was the idea of the project, which Wolfgang asked me to look at. And now I want to tell you a little bit more how we realized it. So one major ingredient for our project was the step to come from a circuit to a set of properties or to a Hamiltonian. And everything has to be automated on the computer. So the first step was to take a circuit to the computer, and the computer gives you a Hamiltonian. So we need an algorithm that takes a circuit and gives you a Hamiltonian, the corresponding Hamiltonian of the circuit. If we have the Hamiltonian, the second step would be to quantize this Hamiltonian. Once we have this Hamiltonian quantized, there are a lot of numerical toolboxes which we can use to analyze this Hamiltonian and then feed back to the computer and let the algorithm go on. So I want to look a little bit more into these three steps, how we can proceed from going from a circuit to a quantum Hamiltonian. Okay, step one, from a circuit to a Hamiltonian. So as I told you, we want to have an algorithm where I can put in a circuit and it gives me the Hamiltonian. So the first thing it has to do, it gets a circuit and it converts the circuit to a graph. So every edge corresponds to an element, and all these nodes correspond to the actual nodes of the circuit. In this way, we have the data in a form which we can actually process with the computer. The second thing is a little bit complicated, but what we have to do is, since we have it in a graph now, we start at a certain node and we search a spanning tree that goes through all the capacitances and spans the whole circuit. So a spanning tree is basically a path through a circuit which does not make any loop and which reaches every node. And we have to do that, and it will become clear in a minute why we are doing that. And you can see that a little bit as a setting a gauge to pick a specific spanning tree, so there is some degree of freedom. And also what we do is we pick a specific ground node where the flux is zero. So having that, we can now build an algorithm that generates from this graph with a spanning tree and the ground node a symbolic term, which is the potential energy. So whenever in this graph is an inductance, it adds this term. And whenever in this graph is a Josephson junction, it adds the cosine term to the potential energy. And now comes the clue with the spanning tree. Why do we need the spanning tree? If for the inductive edge the algorithm is looking at right now, if the parallel capacitance, and we are making sure that there is always a parallel capacitance by introducing parasitic capacitances if there is only an inductive element between two nodes. If this capacitive element is in the spanning tree, then we substitute the flux of the edge just by the difference between the fluxes of the two nodes. If the corresponding capacity is not in the spanning tree, we add an additional flux which corresponds actually to the flux going through the superconducting loop which is formed by the circuit. So whenever in superconducting material, whenever you have a closed loop like here, you will also have a flux that corresponds to the loop. And this flux can actually be used to modulate or to probe your circuit. And that's what we are accounting for when we are adding these terms. So for the circuit you just saw, the potential energy will look something like this. Okay, once we have the potential energy, the algorithm generates something called the C matrix. The C matrix is basically just a matrix that connects, that as an entry has all the connection between the nodes as the capacitances. Since we introduced the parasitic capacitances, none of the entries is zero, so we can invert it, calculate the inverse capacitance matrix, and you will see in a second why we need this, and then setting the parasitic capacitances to zero. So for the circuit which you saw before, the inverted C matrix will look something like that. So what we do then is introducing the momentum conjugate, which we then associate with a charge. And this has exactly the same entries as the flux. Hoppala. Okay, maybe I'll just use my laptop. So, now having set the ground, the algorithm can generate the Hamiltonian for us. The Hamiltonian is given by the inverse C matrix, which I just introduced, and the potential term, which I introduced before. So having this information, with the algorithm can come up with a Hamiltonian given the graph. These are the essential steps, and if you want, I have much more details on that. So this is basically the core that's the heart of our algorithm, how you come up from a circuit to a Hamiltonian. But this Hamiltonian now is still classical. And so far, we didn't do any approximations. Of course, we did small approximations like setting the parasitic capacitances to zero. I mean, that's something you could argue that every element to some extent has a capacitive contribution. But we didn't do any approximation that kind of changed our regime. And that's what we are doing now. Namely, to analyze this numerically, we have to sort of get rid of the cosine term in the Hamiltonian. And this is only valid if we are in the transmon regime. That means that the energy of these Josephson junctions is much bigger than the energy of the capacitances. So what the algorithm does after it generates the Hamiltonian, it does the Taylor expansion of the cosine terms. Okay, so this was the first step. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. So, how can you make sure that you are not missing some important pieces because you want to have what you
want to search system? Yeah, we thought about that, that we are having some way to that we don't have to do the Taylor expansion, because with the Taylor expansion, as you said, we are limiting ourselves to the regimes where that Taylor expansion is valid. And this is only a very small space in the whole space of superconducting circuits. But we didn't found a more general approach to analyze it numerically in the way we want to have the algorithm to work and still keep this generality. And also, if you think about what are the actual qubits the companies are working with, for example, Google, they all, not all, but a lot of them really work with transmons.
Mm-hmm. I thought the whole point of what you are doing is that you want to say, okay, you change things, and then we get to a new world, and we want to investigate the system.
Yes.
So if we do something which is along the line of what they are already doing, maybe we are sort of defeating the purpose in a way.
Yeah, that's true. I guess our hope was that limiting us to the transmon regime is not such a strong limit that we cannot find anything new. But you're absolutely right that it would be wonderful to not have to make this assumption and explore much more of the possibilities which are out there. But maybe we'll come up with a way to do that in the future, but so far we have not implemented anything other than that. Yeah?
Do you think it's just a problem because you have cosine fine and you cannot make it as an operator?
Yes, because that's what's coming now.
But you still restrict your Hilbert space, so you can truncate your Taylor series not to 5 to 4, but then write it as much as you want.
Yes.
You still calculate it.
Yeah. But doing the Taylor expansion, even if you do it to higher order, you lose some properties, namely, for example, the periodicity.
You do Chebyshev expansions and you can actually go to a large parameter, which, even if it's non-perturbative, Chebyshev expansion is a polynomial which describes it even to phi, which is large. I can show you the, how to.
Okay, yeah, that would be nice. Mm-hmm. You mean like with the exponentials? Mm-hmm. Well, at this point, phi is still continuous. I mean, at this point, we are still talking about classical Hamiltonian. But it depends on the basis you choose. Of course, in the phi basis, phi is just a variable, a continuous variable. And there are also analytical solutions for that with the Mathieu functions. Maybe you saw that in the transmon paper. But that's something we were having real challenges implementing that in a general way that you could always solve it analytically given any arbitrary circuit. We don't need, at the end we are only interested in numerical solutions. Yeah, that would be nice. Maybe this our approach is not. But I guess at some point you also have to introduce some sort of cutoff and doing an approximation at a different point, right? That would be nice. I mean, one of the reasons I'm presenting this is because I also want to maybe find better ways to do it. Yeah, cool. So, having the classical Hamiltonian, there are actually two ways what we can do now with this classical Hamiltonian. The first thing is what we just talked about, namely replacing Q and phi by ladder operators, and that's why we did the Taylor expansion before, so that we can do that. Because I would not know how to proceed with the cosinus of ladder operators. But okay, we can discuss that. And then we can actually just feed that in some numerical toolbox, for example, Q-tip, and have a numerical Hamiltonian. Or the other way would be, by the way, this example is the transmon circuit, and this is the transmon Hamiltonian up to fourth order. We could already introduce the two-level approximation by replacing these ladder operators with Pauli matrices. And then we get actually a symbolic expression for the Hamiltonian. This is now in the very familiar way of, written down in the very familiar way of Pauli operators. So these are the two outcomes we can have from the circuit. Okay, so having an algorithm that takes any arbitrary circuit and returns either numeric or symbolic Hamiltonian, what can we do with that? Or what do we want to do with that? So as we are from Innsbruck, I had to add a slide with mountains. And just to remind you a little bit about what are the actual goals we have in mind, what peaks do we want to climb? One of the goals is we want to find a new and improved qubit. Or maybe discover any circuit nobody thought before, which gives you really something new. And also, what we evolved along the lines, basically, is a toolbox which can be used to play around in circuit design. This could be also helpful for the experimentalist. And thirdly, and this is our major goal, is to have some sort of reverse engineering. That means I give the algorithm a specific Hamiltonian, and it tries out and searches and searches and searches, and at some point it gives me a circuit that implements this Hamiltonian. That's what we call reverse engineering, and this is actually our main goal. So what are the knobs we can turn? What can we change? Of course, we can change the composition of the elements in the circuit. Then we can change the size of the elements. So that means the numerical values for the capacitances, for the inductances, for the Chausson energies. We can play around with that and see how it affects, for example, the spectrum of the Hamiltonian. Then, as I told you, this loop flux, we can play around with that and change the external fluxes applied to the circuit. And what we can also do, we can change the variables which we quantize. I mean, nobody says that we have to quantize phi. Maybe phi 1 minus phi 2 would be a good variable to quantize. So that we have a degree of freedom in what do we actually want to quantize, and this is also why there are different platforms in superconducting qubits, where there is a charge qubit, a flux qubit, a phase qubit, because you can quantize different classical variables. What do you mean by that?
Like, you can have more
copy-paste
network structure.
Yeah, okay. Somehow, this is very important for the genetic algorithm, which we have in mind, because it should not generate any instance which is outside the regime. So what we can always check is that this graph is closed, either by putting open ends to the ground or by connecting them. And what we can also do is to check that the transmon regime is valid. That means that the energy of the Josephson junction is much larger than the capacitive energy. Other than that, I think we can play around with a lot of things. And of course, if the circuit is bigger, then you would have more subsystems. Like you would have a qubit here and a qubit here, and then it becomes a network of qubits. And then what we can do is we can check how harmonic are these subsystems. Like maybe I have a LC circuit here, and by mistake, the algorithm thinks that's a qubit and it makes the two-level approximation with a harmonic spectrum, which would be obviously a mistake. So we can analyze all the subsystems which we have in our network, analyze the validity of the transmon regime and also of the harmonicity, and then do the respective approximations. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Is there any chance that you, by claiming your elements, you go to a regime in which the wiring can become much easier? Because maybe you go to a different frequency, I don't know. Maybe your qubit could be not in microwave energy range. Is that something which might at all happen?
To get outside of the microwave? I mean, what sets the regime for the probing frequency is the transition of the qubit. And this is basically for us just numerical value.
Right. But no, of course, you can make a value, but somehow when you realize the circuits, you know, there are certain constraints as to what can be realized, what can be printed, what can be done.
Yeah. Yeah.
So my question is, do these constraints, I mean, in terms of like it has to be some material thing with certain properties, superconducting, whatever, do they constrain you in such a way that it will always be microwaves, or is there any chance that you go outside of that?
Mm-hmm. Actually, by setting the size of the elements, I did not restrict the algorithm yet to anything which would be feasible in the lab. Like, so far, you could give any capacitance to the capacitors, or you could give any Josephson junction energy to the Josephson junctions, and this might be not realizable. But we haven't synchronized these values yet to something which is realistic in the lab.
I guess that will be essential, because when you optimize, so you take your machine learning
That's true. That's true. Yeah, and I guess we have to restrict ourselves to a set of values, which then at the end will always have microwaves as probes.
Standard, it works in 5 gigahertz, and they
there are a lot of degrees of freedom which we could add, but so far we had to restrict ourselves to a certain set of things we want to implement, and then see if this helps, and if this doesn't help, we can go beyond that. But I mean, everything I'm presenting here is no work in progress, and we just started the project more than a year ago. So, yeah. Yeah, that's true.
It is a very broad issue, it can create a lot of benefit. And so this is why I'm asking this question, not so
really. Yeah. And I think that's also something that has to be done. As I heard from personal discussions, is that the semiconductor industry already does these sort of things, like automizing and compiling the circuits. And we as quantum physicists, we are doing it by hand, which is maybe not the most efficient way. Okay, so just a slide on the reverse engineering. So what that means basically is we can ask the algorithm for a certain Hamiltonian term, for example, the sigma y coupling, which we want to implement, and then it tries out either with a genetic algorithm or with a machine learning, and then gives you a circuit that has a certain Hamiltonian output, which implements the term you're looking for. And as I said, this could be either done by a genetic algorithm that just mutates these circuits around, and the results of this can also serve as training data for machine learning algorithm. Okay, by that I am coming to an end, and I'm just saying, like, what are we working on right now? So we are at the moment refining the algorithm a little bit. I set up a second version of the algorithm a couple of months ago, and this is now becoming more and more complex. Then soon we want to add the machine learning aspect, which we haven't done yet. We tried out with a genetic algorithm, and our results have not been as we expected so far, but let's see what's coming up in the future. And then the ultimate goal would be to search for new and improved circuits. That's all what I want to tell today. You mean like to analyze that not just with a Hamiltonian, but with unitary dynamics, but with a open system approach?
Yeah, in some sense, yes.
I mean, so far this is only Hamiltonian design. It's not about the dynamics. So far we didn't make the choice between unitary evolution or open system dynamics.
Maybe it shouldn't be open system dynamics, but let's say if you know that there will be some magnetic impurities, mm-hmm. you should penalize the solutions which make the circuit too sensitive to
okay.
magnetic fields. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it becomes like some Pareto optimization. You want to make your Hamiltonian
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We haven't thought about that yet, but I think that's an important step in the future. But so far, we want to just get the perfect thing working and then try to think about the imperfect cases.
For quantum circuits. And yes, genetic algorithms are not perfect, but they do give some nice solutions. What's the next step is you have the circuit at Hamiltonian, you do supervised learning on some set of the circuits, and then you want to generate new solutions.
Yes.
Without doing the calculation.
Yeah.
So this is very, very big theme in chemistry.
Mm-hmm.
You want to have some molecules, some matter, and then you ask weakly to calculate this spectrum. So this high throughput. And the problems they have, and essentially the workshop for 3 days, everyone was speaking about a single problem. How do we feed in the data? So
mm-hmm.
you have atoms, but you cannot just say that, oh, I have carbon here, hydrogen here.
Yeah.
You need somehow to encode the structure, and the way to do it will be some representation. How do you represent
yeah.
the data?
Mm-hmm.
So have you thought about it? And
yeah.
It will be a big problem for you as well. How do you actually fit in the abstract data of
mm-hmm.
your network?
I could imagine that the input that would be the graph would be just a huge list where every entry of the list corresponds to the element between node I and J. So, for example, entry I plus J in the list would be whatever is between I and J. And then the output would be, if we go back to this, could be a huge vector where every vector amplitude corresponds to the amplitude in the Hamiltonian in a certain basis. Let's say, for this basis, we have the terms 1, sigma z, sigma y, sigma y. So the output could be just a vector with the elements alpha, beta, and gamma. Then you have to restrict yourself to a certain basis. Yeah, what can you do with 6 nodes? Mm-hmm.
You insert the Hamiltonian for the graph itself.
The graph. Like, the input of the would be the graph, and the output would be the Hamiltonian. But the Hamiltonian stored in a vector of amplitudes of terms in the Hamiltonian, and the graph stored as all the elements between the nodes. Of course, these vectors would be very big, but in principle, I don't see some principal problem with that.
Not an expert, you just know that chemistry would be easy if you just say the positions.
Okay, I'm also not an expert on that, but I guess at some point you have to discretize your possibilities, and then you give these discretized choices numbers, and at the end you always have a vector, right, with entries. But yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do your Hamiltonians depend on the spanning tree?
Yeah, that's like the gauge we are choosing.
Do we know the number of spanning trees for a given graph?
Like how many possible spanning trees? Mm-hmm. So for all the graph, calculations, we're using NetworkX. That's a toolbox in Python that has a lot of capabilities. I can see if they also have some method that checks how many spanning trees are there in a graph. But but I think our aim is not to explore everything which is possible, but just to see if we can find something interesting. I don't see a straightforward implementation, but maybe it could. But that would mean like I have to change from Hamiltonian design to quantum circuit design, right? Like to. Yeah.
Maybe less crosstalk, maybe more stability, other sweet spots. And it's a different kind of question you're asking, because if you say, I want many of those, and then want maybe, I don't not need local control.
Yeah.
And this Google stuff is a strict microwave thing which is coming in. Okay, global control, and perhaps the requirements are different.
I think maybe in principle that's possible, but that would be a lot of extra work, because you would also have to add all the decoherence effects which you're just mentioning, and somehow we would need a machinery to analyze those on an algorithmic basis, and this sounds like some huge project. Like
no, but actually crosstalk is not can lead to decoherence, but per se is a process.
Okay.
I'm just talking about a collective system of more such elements.
Mm-hmm.
Just to make the connection.
Yeah.